When I got my first book deal, I was really active in my debut group and just in a lot of different online groups for debut authors. And once we got to the stage where we were all starting to get our first edit letters, I noticed something kind of funny. There was this, not competitiveness exactly, but like, yeah, a little subtle competitiveness over whose edit letter was the longest. It's entirely possible this was all in my head, but it felt like a really long, brutal edit letter meant several different things. My editor is so tough. My editor cares about this book so much. My revision is going to be so huge and I'm going to woe is me about it, but also this is a badge of honor that I'm going to wear with pride. I don't know, it was subtle like I said, and competitiveness isn't really the right word because in general this was a really supportive environment. But there was just this perceived air of legitimacy that came with an eye-poppingly long edit letter. Or at least, I perceived it that way. And yeah, getting your first edit letter and realizing it's basically a novella on its own can be real intimidating, real scary. But it is not always an indication that the revision you're going to have to do is equally massive. In fact, in my case, the biggest gut punch of an edit letter I ever got was also the shortest, but I'm gonna get to that more in a little bit. First, I wanna go over the different stages of edits that you're going to go through in the traditional publishing process. I know there's already a lot of information like that out there, and I've watched a lot of videos about this, I've read a lot of blog posts about this, I've done the research myself, and I've been through it at like three different houses. And I still find it confusing. I think part of that is because every house and every imprint within houses, they do things just a little bit differently. So every author's experience is gonna be a little bit different too. So what I decided to do, instead of basing this explanation off of my own experience, I decided to go to an expert. My friend Rebecca Behrens is a copy editor who has worked at multiple different houses, and she was also the production editor in the managing editorial department at Penguin, who worked on my very first series and also my second series. She got into the nitty gritty with me on how this all works and what the process actually looks like. And honestly, this cleared up a lot of confusion for me, so I hope this is gonna help you too. Fair warning, I've got notes and I don't have all this stuff memorized, so I'm gonna be looking down a lot. To start with, there are two main departments you should be aware of within every house and every imprint. There's an editorial department and a managing editorial department. Some houses also have a production department, but in most cases, the managing ed and production departments are kind of blended. So we are going to start in the editorial department. This is where your acquiring editor works, and they obviously are going to give you your very first edit letter and probably a few more edit letters after that. Your first edit letter is a letter, and it will either be sent to you as a hard copy in the mail or attached as a document to an email or even pasted within the email itself. In this first round, your editor may or may not also attach your manuscript with track changes, with like smaller, a little more line edit-y suggestions as well, but not always. Sometimes it's just a letter. This first round is going to focus on all of the big picture issues like character development or any plot issues, world building issues, things like that. Every subsequent round of edits you do with your editor is probably gonna drill down a little bit more to more like scene level issues. I think on average, I usually end up doing about two rounds of edits with my editors. In one case, I remember doing four rounds, but in a few cases, I've only done one. Next up, still in the editorial department, is line edits. Sometimes your editor, especially if you're doing a later round with like a lighter revision, your editor might do line edits in conjunction with an edit letter. But this does happen before the book goes into copy edits. Line edits do focus on more sentence level writing, but they might still include some sort of big picture edits. Like I said, your acquiring editor usually does this, but not always. Their assistant might do this, especially if it's a new assistant who's learning the ropes and they're doing these line edits with the editor's supervision. Or if your acquiring editor is like a senior editor or an executive editor, they might have another editor in the department or an assistant do the line edits. It's very, very rare, but sometimes line edits are freelanced, are outsourced, but that's more common in nonfiction than in fiction. Once this is finished, we move from editorial to managing editorial, and this is when your book goes into copy edits. It is worth noting that depending on how your contract is worded and how many payments your advance is split into, this might be a point, and it often is, where another installment of your advance is released. When you see an author popping the cork on a bottle of champagne because she's moved into copy edits, it might not be because she's so excited about the copy edits, she's ready for the money. Now, longer novels, including middle grade, young adult, and adult novels, are very often done by a freelance copy editor who's contracted by the house but does not work in the house. Shorter middle grade novels, chapter books, picture books, and early readers are usually done in-house by a staff copy or production editor. And some small houses might not have any copy editing staff in-house, so they would freelance out these shorter books too. Also, some high-profile longer novels are copy edited in-house because of things like embargoes, because of a rushed schedule, like if they're crashing a book, which means just getting it out in a ridiculously short amount of time, or because the publisher really wants to ensure quality control. We're talking about the imprint's biggest, most award-winning, best-selling authors, celebrity authors, high-profile brands and licenses, movie tie-ins, things like that. I have opinions on the copy editing stage and what copy editing actually is, because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding here, and copy editors are amazing people that do a very specific kind of work that's really hard to do well, and I'm going to save that for another video because I would just go off on a 10-minute tangent here, and I want to keep this focused. Next up, first pass pages. This is the first time the text is in layouts with the book design in place. Up until now, your book has been a Microsoft Word document, and now it looks like this. You'll get it either as a PDF or as a hard copy. This is a super fun stage because it's the first time you really start it seeing to look like an actual published novel. A proofreader will check these pages word for word against the manuscript text to make sure that everything is there, and also will make additional corrections, things like typos and grammar, style, content changes that might have been missed in line edits or copy edits. Proofreading may pick up on sentence level concerns like echoes and repetition, but it's mainly to make sure that everything from the manuscript has correctly made it onto the proofs. The author reviews the first pass pages at most houses and will see these proofreading marks, although some publishers make the choice to send the author final pages instead as their pass, in which case they won't see all the proofreader's marks and changes, but just lingering queries. Whether or not this is appropriate is kind of questionable, because the proofreader may have made changes to the text that was actually intentional on the author's part. When the author reviews their first pass pages, they have the opportunity to make final small edits and also to stet, or basically reject, proofreading edits that they don't agree with. First pass pages are typically what is printed in arcs and galleys. Note that what prints in an arc or galley should have gone through the copy editing process with the author, but the author has probably not had a chance to review past pages yet, so there can still be a lot to clean up, and that's why arcs shouldn't be treated as the final work, nor should they be sold. Do not sell arcs or galleys. Ever. Sometimes text has been accidentally cut or copied incorrectly, there can be design and formatting mistakes, and occasionally unauthorized changes have been made in arcs that will later be corrected. First pass pages are sometimes sent out to a freelancer, but more commonly, at least at larger houses, they're done in-house. Smaller or independent publishers with a smaller production team might freelance out their proofreading. Second pass pages and onward, because yes, sometimes you get a third pass and a fourth. And a fifth. In some cases, a book can get up to 7 passes. That shouldn't happen, but sometimes it does. Usually starting with the second pass, the proofreader or production editor is just checking that changes were done correctly. They're not reading the whole book. Sometimes a managing editor will add a cold read, which means reading the whole book for typo level edits. It's not checking it against a previous pass. They might do that in with a later pass, especially if the book had a messy production process, if it involved heavy editing, if it's higher profile, and they want to make sure errors aren't sneaking through. These passes are almost always done in-house, again at the larger houses, sometimes with the smaller house, this is also freelanced out. Generally, authors don't get a chance to check on these passes. Their editor will sign off on the corrections. If there's any doubt over whether or not the author would approve of the change, as in if we're not just talking about a misspelled word, the editor would reach out and email them and just get their approval. The final steps in this process are things like F&G, printer proofs, and book approvals. When I saw that, I was like, what the heck is an F&G? And I had to ask Rebecca to explain it to me, and here is her explanation. F&Gs stands for folded and gathered, and it's a set of unbound signatures that the printer sends along with a jacket or cover proof, typically for picture books or other full color books with a lot of art. It's kind of like the arc of the picture book world. As for printer proofs and book approvals, this is the stage where a production editor checks the final versions of the interior and other components that the printer sends and approves them for printing. These proofs and approvals route to the entire publishing team. The publisher, the editor, the design director, the designer, the managing editor, the production editor, everyone looks at it for approval and everyone has to sign off. Here, it's not so much about the content anymore, it's about the packaging. It's about making sure that the cover and jacket elements are all in place, the final art is in place, there's no text missing, etc. It is expensive to make changes at this point in the process, so this isn't the time for discretionary editing unless it's something really egregious. Also, checks and balances happen throughout this process. For example, whoever did the copy edit will not be assigned to do the first pass pages. This is so you have multiple eyes on the project and someone else can catch the previous editor's mistakes. Also, it's just always good to have more eyes on a thing because they won't all have the same knowledge holes or blind spots. Once it gets to the later passes, like second pass pages and onward, the same editors can do those checks, but it's usually alternating. And this is why scheduling projects can get very tricky for managing editors. There are, as you can see, a lot of moving parts happening here. Okay, so all of that info came from Rebecca. She knows her stuff, and she's worked on the majority of my novels, if not as a copy editor or production editor, then as my critique partner. I can attest to her meticulous attention to detail. She is just a great editor to have at any stage in the process, and side note, she's available to hire on Readzy. I will link her profile in the description below. Now that we've covered the whole editorial process, I want to get more into that first edit letter, the big one. The scary one. If you're interested in what that letter actually looks like, I have a video on book critiques where I share my whole edit letter for the first book in the Secrets of Topsy series, and I will link that up here and in the description below. It was a pretty intense revision, but it was not the scariest edit letter I ever got. That one was not from one of my editors, but from my agent, and it was also the shortest. And it was also not technically a letter, but a phone call. And what she did was very kindly and very succinctly explain to me that my plot was not one plot, but three plots that I had crammed into one book. She told me very specifically what those three plots were and said that if I wanted this book to succeed, I needed to choose one and write that story. If you want all the gory details, I tell the whole sad saga in my video about rewriting versus revising, and I'll link that up here and also down below if you want to check it out. But the short version is that I did not take my agent's editorial suggestion very well, and that is why Olive and the Backstage Ghost was published 7 years after I wrote that first draft. Why was I scared? Because my agent's very short and to the point edits made me realize that my book did not need a revision, it needed a rewrite. And to me, rewrite meant start over. But as I talk about in that previous video, it is not starting over. The analogy I used in that video is that your draft is like a really structurally unsound Jenga tower. Revising a draft that's in that condition is like pulling more pieces out, making more holes, and just praying that the whole thing doesn't fall over. Rewriting it is purposefully, intentionally knocking the tower down, but recognizing that the pieces are still there, and now you can build up a structurally sound tower. Yes, it does take some time, and that can be really intimidating, but it is not starting over. The work you did in that first draft wasn't for nothing. The Jenga pieces didn't just vanish. In many ways, at least for me personally, I find that rewriting is more freeing and even sometimes faster than revising. Okay, so what makes a really great edit letter if it's not about the length? Here's my take. I know I'm reading a great edit letter when it makes me feel scared, but in the excited way. In a great edit letter, the editor understands your book and sees it for its full potential. They see the vision, and their suggestions are clearly going to help you get there. Reading her thoughts and her ideas makes you see what your novel could really be. There's still fear, yeah, because what if I can't reach that potential? Because fear of failure, because. But the excitement that you get at kind of realizing that vision for what your book could be? It's the same feeling I get when I first have an idea for a novel. Don't you feel scared then too? When you're in that early stage, when you haven't really even started writing the book yet, you're just like developing the idea in your mind. And you almost kind of don't even want to start writing it because what if it doesn't come out as brilliant as it is in your mind? That's the good kind of fear, the excited kind. And a great editor is going to make you feel that way about your book all over again. I hope you guys found that helpful. If you did, please don't forget to hit that like button and maybe share this video with a writer you know who would find it helpful too. I will see you guys later this week with another video, and I hope you have a great week. Bye.